Warashina. She's been working in clay for
over 15 years
now. And she was a student, was born in Spokane, but then was a student at both for both her MFA and her BFA at University of Washington. And then spent some time teaching.
In the Midwest.
Yes, Wisconsin State was one stop. Eastern Michigan was another. And then you came here and you did a little stint.
And I did it for,
Cornish, right?
Cornish,
yeah.
For about 2 years.
Before she spent 25 years at the University of Washington and retired in 1995 to focus full time on her studio work.
Uh-huh.
So, let's start at the beginning, Patti.
I can leave.
Let's start at the beginning. Let's go back to Spokane.
All right.
What was it like growing up in Spokane?
Well, it was, I was born in 1940. And so, you know, that living in Spokane was like living in agricultural, you know, Mecca. And it was a railroad center. And I would say that as a kid, it was pretty boring. Because it didn't have a lot of culture. There was, you know, the, you could go to, you know, lake and stuff, but you'd have, that was a big, you know, day trip.
What was the biggest cultural thing going on over there?
My grass and my lawn. And it got hot during the summer. We used to go swimming, but, you know, I mean, culturally, at least, you know, I took violin lessons and things like my sister was to piano, but, you know, it was a pretty, you know, at that time, it was very, there wasn't much to do. And so I spent a lot of time on the grass. I'm not kidding. Laying on the grass and tumbling with my friends, and I just remember lying down there and then looking. We had great clouds,
uh-huh.
So I used to look at the clouds, and I remember just kind of daydreaming. Uh-huh. So I think a lot of that. I think there's some artists that came out of that Eastern Washington, and I think it, because it was so void that you.
Yeah, nothing to do but imagine.
Yeah, I mean, you get these fantasies.
That's cool.
But I really think that probably stimulated a lot of imagination. I really think so.
Well, I can see that. I can see that. And I think if we look around, we can. There's no doubt that Patti's got plenty of imagination to go around. So growing up, you have two parents who had immigrated from Japan.
My mother was second generation. My dad
was,
came over when he was about 18, and then he learned English in high school, took a year in high school, and then he ended up going to dental school and became a dentist, and that was on the coast. And my mother's and father's marriage was arranged through the community, and then they needed a dentist in Spokane, and so that's how he ended up there, because it was a pretty small, it wasn't a big Japanese community, but it was enough that it could support two churches, one Christian and one Buddhist church.
Okay.
And we went to the, of course, went to the Methodist church, which, and Roger Huber always teases me about that.
Roger Huber.
Yeah, because he used to go to these big conferences, you know, these church conferences that were from the, oh, the, you know, Japanese conferences, they have like maybe, you know, 500 people. And he used to tease me because he'd catch me these photographs and say, hey, Patti, you were in this conference, you know, this Christian conference. And he, of course, Roger was there. He would deny it, but.
If those of you aren't familiar with Roger Shimomura, he's a artist, 2D artist. Currently, he's based out in Kansas City, right? He's a professor at KU. Or no.
And he shows at Greg's.
And,
Kansas.
Not, where's Kansas?
University of Kansas.
University of Kansas is in Lawrence.
Thank you.
Right.
That's
right.
Yeah.
Right.
So were either of your parents, were they artistic?
Yeah, my mother was really, my dad being a dentist was really good with his hands. And I think he also was very, when he was young in Japan, he had an art teacher he used to always talk about. And then my mother was really very skilled. And she had a great eye, my mother. She used to collect antiques and Japanese things that, you know, it was pretty unusual for Eastern Washington. And my folks didn't have a lot of money, but I always felt that we always had a really visually rich environment.
Sure.
You know?
Well, you've talked a little bit when we've personally been talking in the past about growing up during that time, during World War II. But living in Spokane, your family was affected maybe a little bit less than the people that were right here on the coast, but still, what was that like?
It was, my mother, if you ever broached the subject with her, she would always get teary-eyed. because it was, you know, they were being watched. My dad being a community leader.
Right.
They were watching him. And so one time, my brother came running downstairs and said, "Mommy, Mommy, there's somebody upstairs there." The FBI was going through the trunks and stuff, through the bedrooms. And at the very same time, they were checking my dad's office, going through things, you know, office thing. And then they froze bank accounts, so they couldn't get money. So the funny thing about this was my dad's patients were German, a lot of them were German immigrants, because they were being ostracized too. So
sure.
I remember growing up when I was a kid, and we used to go up to South Hill and take cookies to Mrs. Angelos. And I remember going in there, and she had these carousels that would go round and round, you know, wooden ones that were, I guess, from Germany. And so all those little things kind of, I think, affected me later. So I'm kind of becoming a hoarder.
Were you a little kid? Were you involved in art projects? Were you doing artistic things? Or?
It was like this when I was young. My dad and mom kind of programmed us to go into sciences. You know, say, you know, they want you to earn a living. So art was on the agenda. And living in Canada wasn't that. But you know, it's really funny when I, when I got to the university, I had to take high school art classes. But when I was in grade school, I remember I used to be assigned to do these murals in the back, like Thanksgiving mural, like pilgrims and turkeys and all that stuff, Santa Claus and stuff like that. But once I got to high school, I kind of ignored all the art classes, thinking I was going to go into some science area.
Right. And so when you ended up coming to UW, was that still the track you were on at that point?
Yes.
So let's talk about when that changed.
So it was in my freshman year, and I had this elective, and I thought, well, gee, that'd be, let's say, kind of fun. I'll pick a drawing class. So I remember taking this drawing class, and I didn't even know what a charcoal stick was, and I was more nervous about that class because I knew people were, you know, pretty talented that would be in that class, and I didn't, you know where to start from square one. So when I took the class, I ended up really liking a lot of, wow, this is really cool. So I remember taking the next quarter, I decided to take a design class and getting design class, and that really freaked me out. Not, you know, because it sounds so esoteric and like, and I still can't figure it out. But so I just kept taking one class after another, but I was, you know, thinking still I was going to go on this science track. But eventually, this counselor told me, she says, "Well, Pat, let me just admit it."
You're in denial.
I was.
And what about your first experience with clay?
Okay, so then one day I was walking down the hall, it was on the main floor of the art building at the UW, and it was on the end of the T, everybody probably is familiar with that, and that's where the pawn shop used to be. And I remember going by there all the time and looking in there, and it looked like people were really having fun. So then I took, after completing the UW, do all the foundation classes, so I took this clay class, and I went, and then I think I took a painting class, but I went, oh wow, this is great. It was really funny with the clay. It's with people that get into clay, it's like it just grabbed the first thing. I mean, I couldn't leave it, and I took a lot of painting.
So was it a tactile thing first? You just like how it felt, or were you excited about what you could make with it, or?
It was the feeling of it, I think. Yeah. You know, and then also trying to the wheel was a real drawing card. I mean, just trying to see if you could make an object, you know, off its wheel. And I would stay, in the beginning, I would stay until I would kick it out. Shouldn't be out by 11. And later on, as an undergraduate, you couldn't stay there past 11, or you could get on the weekend. So I used to leave, I used to leave the window ajar on the quad. And I get up on the locker and unlock it, then I leave. And then I come back on the weekend and I sneak through that window. And then I jump off the locker and jump down and go to my studio. And then I got.
Never get caught?
No, I never got caught doing that. But, but I had a studio in the basement, way in the back. It was like two rooms back. And there was no windows back there. But I could hear the police coming at night. At 11 o'clock, they come to check all the doors and stuff. Or on the weekends, you know, they'd come and check, and I could hear the first set of doors, and you could hear the jangling of keys. So what I did was, I would jump off my wheel, and of course the wheel's still going around. and there's slip all over the place. But I couldn't turn the lights on because I had to hurry up and get it. So I'd hide in these wooden lockers. There's still the wooden lockers.
You would just jump in there?
Yeah, I would just get in there and hide and pull the doors closed. And then I could hear the police guy come in through the door, you know, jangling. And then as soon as he'd leave, he'd kind of look around and hear him, you know, just kind of, you know, look, spacing out, looking around, you know. And as soon as he left, you know, like he'd come back out. But it was kind of weird in the beginning, but I got to know the grad students.
Okay.
They were down the hall for me, and they used to let me in after a while.
Anybody in that group that ended up becoming somebody we would know about now, or?
Well, Chuck was in my undergraduate.
Chuck Close.
Yeah, he was in my painting class.
Yeah.
And he was amazing.
I need more context. What year are we? 60?
1958. 1958 to 62 was undergrad, and 62 to 64 was master's.
Okay, thank you.
It was way before you were born.
So at this point, were you still hiding all this from your parents?
Well,
or they, you fessed up by then?
It was fortunate my father passed away when I was 10, because my dad probably killed me. No, but my mother, I had this great mother, and she was, she was kind of worried about, you know, whatever, the children were going to do. And when I finally told her that I was thinking about going to art, she says, fine, you know, she says, if you do something you love to do, you'll do it well. So that was like very encouraging. And then when I told her I was going to go to grad school, she said, fine, I'll help you. And I was, she's very supportive. And I didn't know what I was going to do after I got out. I had no idea. So my deal was I was going to see about going down to Mills for a graduate school. And then I met this, I was running a friend of mine who told me to stay at the U because he was going to go to medical school up there. And so I stayed at the UW and instead of going to California. And
was this love that was keeping you there, or was this just an acquaintance?
It was kind of an acquaintance. Meg knows who it is. Anyway, so I stayed, and then when I went to grad school, I was really wondering what the heck I was going to do after. So I thought maybe what I would do is get an undergraduate degree and then go to Whitworth College, go back to Spokane, go to Whitworth College, pick up an education degree, and then end up trying to teach high school or grade school or whatever. That was my plan. And then what happened when I was in grad school, I got this TA. And then I realized that teaching college, I had no idea.
Right, right, yeah. It's like the light bulb.
Yeah, I didn't even know. I mean, and then I remember when I got the TA, they did put you up with, usually now, I think they sign you up with another instructor to teach a class. But at that time, they used to say, okay, here's your class, go teach it. And I remember first class lasted 5 minutes. I told my name, the course number, the tools to bring in. I'll see you next time.
At this point, when you first started teaching, were you still making functional pottery, or had you kind of switched gears yet?
Well, it's really funny because Bob Spirit, my teacher, and Harry Myers, who was a protege of Wolkus, and they were both really incredible guides. But Bob, you know, in undergrad, he really encouraged us to do a lot of experimental work. He, you know, he encouraged pottery, to do pottery a lot, but he really said, you know, kept pushing, kept telling you to do, you know, more sculpture and stuff. So that's kind of, you know, you're always kind of on the edge. I think that really taught me a lot, is that you just keep pushing the envelope, right? And so it was kind of one of those habits that I think that was built in when I was, you know, as an undergrad.
So was Wolkus one of your, would that be your biggest kind of influence at that point to kind of push you in that direction of going more
Bob really admired Wolkus because he worked with him in Montana, coming from the Chicago Art Institute. And he stopped there and worked with him for, 3 or 4 months. So then everybody admired Wolkus that was on the West Coast. And it was a pretty conservative time then. It's mostly throwing, stoneware, and a lot of it was influenced by these big organizations were back in New York. But Focus was the key person who really opened ceramics up, and not just for the U.S., but he, I think, opened it up for international. Because things, before he, when he started to throw these, you know, he was an incredible clay at, you know, massive levels, you know, throwing it on the wheel and then making it stick to it and beating it with a, you know, like with a piece of lumber. He was being influenced by the African Expressionist painters. And so that was like, people thought he was crazy. They thought, what is this stuff? You should do this, terrible.
Right. And plus, at that time, clay with a pretty big stigma attached to it as not being anywhere on par with painting or sculpture.
And so it almost always had that problem. But he was the one that really opened it up. And then what happened, I think, because of Volkus' personality, he had this charisma and attracted a lot of very masculine, heavy-duty guys around him, and they started a movement, you know, on the West Coast, and it eventually, you know, like Tomina and all these people would come, because that was during the New Gay interest of pottery, and they would come to this country, and they kind of admired each other, you know. It's like, and who's this, you know, heavy-duty guy, like, this, you know, mashing this clay around, and it had a lot of power, and I think what happened is, after that point, then it just started to go, you know, internationally. You know, people started to say, you could do more than what's obvious with the clay, and you could experiment, and so, after that, then there's people like Bob Artisan, I think the first person I remember that I remember reading in Craft Horizon magazine was David Gabuli. I saw him, there was an article in there, and it was, he made this hip ponds and lily pads, which is a big floor piece. And I think that was the first time I remember seeing anything that was, you know, a natural image. And then I think Artisan was starting to pop up, like it was considered the pop art, you know, that era. So he started painting, he's got a very loose, everything was kind of loose then, because it was being affected by the African Expressionism. You know, everything, you don't do anything tight, because, you know, it's, so you had to make everything fluid and paint. And
were you being influenced by all of that?
Oh, yeah, I was very, you know, I thought it was great, you know. And, I had this thing where I never felt comfortable doing, I mean, I took a lot of painting, my boss used to say, take a lot of painting, because, you know, when you're in ceramics, you have the surface to deal with, when you have to learn how to paint on the surface. So I took a lot of painting, and I had a friend of mine who had a lot of aprons and sphere books. So I used to go through these books, and because in Seattle at that time, there was a lot of stuff in Seattle I used to do, and a lot of national and international stuff. So I used to go through these Abrams books, and I fell in love with the surrealism, and I used to look at a lot of Magritte was like my, and he did all these natural, you know, these using natural form, realistic forms, and he wasn't using, you know, he wasn't doing this abstraction, and everything was tight, and then, so he gave me, when I was looking at these books, I went, wow, you know, here's this guy's doing a lot of tight painting. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. Because before they say, oh, it's too tight. And so that kind of gave me confidence to, you know, like, you would make it tight, make it really tight.
Right. And so for you, we're talking, I think, mid-1970s now? That piece there is 76.
Yeah, that's pretty easy.
Is that kind of the start of it?
No, I think it's earlier.
Okay.
Yeah.
So once you...
I was doing machine sculptures and things like that when I was in school.
Yeah. After we're done here, once we're done, take an opportunity to walk around the corner here. There's three pieces around the corner here that are not part of the show, but they're three earlier works that show the range of work that Patti's been doing through the years. And there's a piece from 1976, which is... Where the way you displayed it to me was that was before you really could do a figure fully the round, so you did the painted part of the painted and stuck some arms.
Okay. I think what happened was that I realized that I wanted to do realistic objects, and I learn how to work with patterns. And so when I did these drawings on paper of the moondog dream and the pear-shaped turkey and all these things, I could see it and I could figure out, if I did a pattern, making patterns of, I could see exactly how big they were going to be. And I knew exactly how much clay to roll out. And that was a real, that period was a real learning period for me. And I really, it turned out that I wasn't afraid of the material anymore. And then also I got these kind of hard-edged shapes that I needed. And so later on I was looking at all this surrealism and realizing that there was all these figures in it, and I was afraid to approach this figure because when I was in school, nobody would be classically dead in a figure class. Nobody.
It just wasn't.
It was
cool.
Yeah. And so, because everything was abstract expressionism. And so I started out with these kilts, making these kilts with bricks. And then I decided, well, I was going to make a carp, what they call a carp kill. For some of you who aren't ceramics, a car kill is a kill which has a rail on it, and the cart comes out and you load the wear on it, and then you shove it back in the kill. And so I decided to do my version of a car kill, which was a car that was made out of bricks, and it was flame. It was flaming. So that was my first attempt at doing something a little bit, you know, like a figure, just like a human figure.
Sure.
And so I liked the forms of the cars that had kind of rounded balloon things, and that gave me a lot of confidence that maybe I could venture into making a figure.
Right.
And so then I decided, so then what I decided the easiest way to approach a figure was flat. So I'm going to do these graphite drawings. So I did these kind of, actually that thing, that it's called a women's shrine series. I did these graphite drawings of these portraits of these women, and if I could draw it, that meant that I could probably attempt to make it. So I had to get my confidence up. And then once I did actually the pyramids first, and they were flat drawings. I kind of took my learning experience with clay, I took it one step at a time. Like I started doing, once I did the pattern pieces that I was talking about, I decided that I had to learn something about the surface. So then I decided to pick up an airbrush, and I don't know why. And then I decided that I'd take these pyramids and I'd use them like a flat canvas, except you've got four sides. And they were stacked, they were actually stacked boxes in the style of these Japanese lacquer boxes that people put store food in. And in this case, what I did was I made them triangular, and they were like 3 feet high, and they're stacked, hollow construction. And then I had these flat surfaces that I could do these drawings, and then that would teach me something about glazing. So I took that period of time, and then that's when I started evolving into these single figures on one side. I'd have the front side would be the figure, the back side would be his back, the two sides would be the arms, and they're all painted flat. And then I decided I would do these women's shrine series. I'd do the same thing, except this time it's this trapezoid idea of putting the figure flat on the surface with very little relief, and then eventually bring the arms out. So I'm creeping out into this figure, right? Because I'm just taking it one step at a time. And kind of scared of it.
Yeah.
I'm really scared. And so finally,
were you afraid of not being cool?
No, it wasn't that. I was afraid to do the figure because I just wasn't familiar with it. But and then what happened was I had the cars already done. So I decided I was going to make a figure to go inside the car. And that's what started that whole series. I did 10 years of work with the figure. And it was the reason why I ended up that size was because I was trying to cram these figures through the car.
Sure.
And that's why they became that scale. And once I did the very first one, and it was during the women's movement, I was like, you know, Jewish Chicago people. Anyway, so I did this figure, and she was sitting on the hood of this car. And it was the very first figure I modeled, and I went, oh, cut it, it was really hard for me.
Yeah.
And then she had cheeks, you know, going off the wind, and these broken telephone lines. And I got some confidence from it.
Yeah.
And so then I said, well, I'm going to start working with these figures. And so I did 10 years worth of just trying to learn how the body movement,
yeah,
the muscles move,
sent the piece up at the Washington State Convention Center. It's definitely worth checking out. I won't say it was the kind of the tour de force of that period, but probably it's a massive piece.
It was getting toward, I think, about 9 years, 8 years worth, and so I got this figure and how I was going to make it look right. I feel like right now I'm going
says, I have to do this? Is it a big, scary?
No, it's not scary. It's because I'm trying to teach myself something. Like when I did the airbrushing, I'm trying to learn how to paint on a surface, how to deal with two-dimensional surface. So each period I've taken it, you know, this idea, and I knew I was trying to edge toward this kind of, you know, these figures I feel like are, they don't talk about a nationality. You know, I take the clothes off, I get rid of it, I try to make them abstract, so that you're not, when you look at them, you don't know what period of time they came from. So let's say about 200 years from now, you look at this, you don't know that it was made, it could be made in any period.
Right.
And it wasn't something that I knew about, but it's something that I could feel. So, and I also didn't want to make it, like sometimes I use it, like I'll use a culture with it, like, you know, like there was one called You Captured My Heart, which was a Japanese woman with a geisha,
sure,
the fan, I'll never forget.
And you've done like sake sets and things like that.
Yeah, but it's, yeah.
But
and
usually
so
they're
usually
political
I try,
or something.
Yeah, but I try to, the figures themselves, I've been trying to abstract them. So that, and then also, I don't like putting clothes on them, because once you put the clothes on them, then it identifies the culture that it came from.
Sure.
So like the last period, or this period where I was using geometric, I'm still kind of in it, where I'm thinking about painting. And painting, so when I'm doing the figures, and you know, like I'll take a geometric shape that crosses the figure. Mm-hmm. What I'm thinking about in these things is like there's painting that's floating in the back or in front of the thing. It's kind of invisible. And when it does it, it crosses, especially this piece back here. What's happening, the shapes are moving across the figure, and they just happen to land, say, on his cheek, or they land across his breast, but they're floating shapes. That's what I was thinking about.
So you spent 25 plus years, about 30 years, teaching. What was teaching like? I mean, was it something that
it was amazing. It was one of the best jobs I could ever have.
What did you love about it?
I liked that the students were great.
Yeah.
And what I liked about the students was that they were energetic, they were there to learn, and it also kind of stimulated, you know, like they always had problems. And so it's kind of like problem solving. And in fact, that's what art is, I think, it's problem solving. You know, if it's too easy and you figure it out, why do it again, right? That's my figure.
Sure.
So I think the students, you know, that help stimulate that idea of thinking all the time. And then also the fact that students, they're all different. You all from different, have different backgrounds, and so your ideas are all different. You know, because you know, some of them might be more abstract, or some of them might be more historical. So you're always thinking. You always try to figure out, you know, what is it? Because you're not trying to make a clone.
Right.
You know, you're trying to get them to think about who they are,
yeah,
and how you express your own feelings.
Do we have any students? Former students? We have a few here.
Former?
Yeah, several.
But not.
What was Patti like as a teacher?
Not.
Because I've heard this. Word on the street was you were tough. Is what I heard.
Well,
I heard you were strict. But in a way that was disarming.
Really?
That I was told that you would.
It's not true.
Yeah, no, I was told by one of your former students that you were really strict, but you would do it in a way where you kind of tease them about it. You'd be like, oh, why are you doing nothing? When somebody would sit around just to kind of spur him along.
Oh, I could be.
Any thoughts from former students?
You can say it, you guys.
Helpful, okay.
I wasn't a student, but I just saw her outside Parnassus and knew about her and the mysterious studio there. I was up in the painting section, but Spencer Mosley was close with, and so he spoke about Patti, and
yeah,
she was a mysterious character.
Well, and you've referenced a couple times that Bob, you're talking about Robert Sperry, and you have been married to two people who were both ceramists.
I wouldn't advise that. I was kidding.
During those times, I mean, were you guys, we won't talk about
no.
The other one. During those times, though, were you collaborating with each other? Were you guys feeding off of each other? Were you completely doing your
Fred was extremely talented. I mean, he's really talented. But no, I think we were very independent of each other's work. And Bob worked totally different than I did. But it wasn't, it was just like, you know, we both respected each other because we were both pretty serious artists. Not knowing what that means, but we're both serious about it. And so, and I think teaching was a really great tool because when you're teaching, you're not making clones, like I said. So what you're trying to do is, you know, have people try to do the self-analysis and try to get whatever's inside out. And Bob and I both taught, and so I think that was one of the things that we both had in common, is so he respected his work, I respected his work, he respected the way I thought. You know, and I would, you know, every once I asked him, you know, when he thought, you know, I'd say, hey, come on, keep Bob in line. Because I'd always say, oh, Bob, I see. Throw them in the pile, and then if I
Does it always start with sketching?
Generally, yeah, I think so, yeah. Or it could come from a title. A lot of times a title kick off something.
That's kind of a reverse process, I think, for most artists.
And then I can see, you know, I can see something from that title or a word.
Right. Well, looking at this body of work we have around us, little brief background on this is in 2013, Patti had an opportunity to do a residency down at the Museum of Glass in Tacoma. So she showed up there with a couple of those sketches or a number of them.
Well, it was really hard. This is probably one of the hardest shows I've ever done. And the reason why was I kind of put this residency off until after I had the two shows, one in California and one up here. And I just wanted to get it out of the way so I could think clearly.
The title of our show, Thinking Clearly.
So I told the Glass Museum I could do it right after. And so I did it. I accepted to go down there. And Ben told me, the head gaffer, there's four blowers down there. And he said, well, Pat, I'll call you a month before, and then I want you to tell me what you're thinking about.
Sure.
So he calls me a month before, and I told him, I have this idea I want to do. And you're going to be down there for 5 days, 8 hours a day, with four blowers. So, and you're on the spot. And plus, a woman put up a lot of money for me to come down there, and they put you in a hotel, you know, every night, and then they feed you. So, you know, you're kind of,
like,
you know,
camp.
Yeah, but, you know, it's like a lot of money somebody's put up. You know, so I can't just, like, say, fuck it off, say, oh, I'm going to go have, I'm going to make 100 wine glasses.
Because it's like in your mind, it's like coming out of the figure, and then is the figure under it, or is the porcelain in the glass? Like, how are you thinking? Are you working towards, I mean, it's like a battle's kind of, not battle, but there's a tension between where the glass is and the porcelain.
Are you talking referring to this piece?
In particular, yeah, it's like kind of under glass, but then it's also,
well, you know, I did a piece a long time ago, and I was thinking about, you know, down in the Southwest, this design came a long time ago, and in the Southwest, these people, the scientists were living in these bubbles.
Oh.
They're like in their own.
They're about to do it at Amazon campus.
Right, and they live within this, it's an ecosystem within this bubble. This is a long time ago. And I think that's what I was kind of thinking of in the beginning, was like this is kind of an enclosed environment.
Sure.
And anyway, the other two people, one of them cracked, the fourth one cracked, and the museum took another one, and the collector took the other one. But I can't tell you the description, I can't describe it to you.
Why not? Can I?
No.
What did you say?
Well, if you want to know about it, we'll talk about it later when she's not listening. One thing I love with this body of work is that you are doing about four or five different things for the first time. One, you're working glass. Two, you were etching on glass.
Yes, that's why it took me so long, because I was really petrified when I got these glass pieces back. I told them what I was thinking about. But I didn't know how to etch on glass, and I didn't know how to scribe. I had no idea. And somebody told me that I could go to this store, a glass store, and you can buy this paste. And also, if you want to etch it, you know, use this etching paste. And then also you get diamond drill bits. And so I was like, I don't know, I was just thinking, I just took me so long to figure it out. And they called me two or three times in the museum. They wanted to pick up their piece. I owed them the collector a piece, and I owed the museum a piece. And it was like, I think they called me three times. And I still was like sitting on it, you know, trying to figure it out.
2 years already.
It was 2 years, and I was like really like just out of my mind. And so finally, I got six pieces then, and then they came up, chose the ones they wanted, and took them. I was just petrified, I didn't know what to do. So anyway, Akio was telling me, Pat, he had done some cast glass piece, I think it was a pilcha.
Akio Takamori, who actually Pat hired, right, at UW?
Yeah.
Pat was the person who brought Akio on to the department.
Yeah. Anyway, so Akio said, Pat, just do it. You know, and Akio, he's one of those kind of artists that he can just, you know, just dives into it and just gets it done. I'm sitting there.
Duh.
2 years later, and he says, "Pat, just do it." And so finally, I remember hearing his words. And I think this was one of the first pieces I did.
And then also LEDs, lasers.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah.
Where did that come from?
Well, you know, it's like, you know how I think that you know these headpieces. Life is stressful. And I think that's kind of what I was thinking about with these headpieces. And so, and also like that one, the one back there with it's called sensor, and it's because like hearing and seeing and the mouth being sent. And I can tell you a story about 2-3 years ago. I had an invitation and with two other artists to ship some work overseas. And I won't tell you which country because I don't want to. And so anyway, in here we were invited to show, and all this correspondence went back. It was such a quagmire. I mean, it was just like eating your time out, you know, I don't care if I have a show.
Right.
So anyway,
correspondence was about the content of the work, or?
Well, it was just, you know, just this red tape and all this stuff.
Sure.
Well, anyway, so then it got down to the end where, you know, they're going to have a 21-person jury to view the work. I said, screw that, I'm not doing this.
Yeah.
It's just, it's because they want to censor the work.
Right.
I mean, I won't tell you which country it was, but I figured, you know, and then I started thinking about it. I started thinking about that we have such, you know, we are so lucky to live here. And I can say anything about person, almost, and get away with it. And nobody's going to censor me. And, you know, we have such a luxury of doing what we want. I mean, doing this kind of work or, you know, and so that's what that piece is about. It's about censorship. And then also about thinking. And so when I had those guys make me, I didn't really know how it was going to end up. I just said, hey, you guys, blow me these glass hats. And I knew I wanted them to be kind of my size. And then this one, the reason I use laser, I mean, that's a strobe lights. And I wanted them, you can program it so you can make multiple one color, and they can go in and out.
You've been having lots of fun with it. She has a really cool remote that you can also do.
And I didn't really know how, I really didn't know what I was doing. I just kind of went down the line and said, hey, you know, I'm thinking about this idea. I have no idea what I'm doing. And anyway, I struggled with that. And then this one, it's a laser. It's a laser. And,
it's called Brainstorm.
It's kind of called Brainstorm. And so what I did was, the reason why it's painted the way it is because the kind of the laciness of the lights, you know, I couldn't paint it in a more abstract way. And I decided to, that's why the surface became the way it did.
Any questions? Anybody? Question is there one piece that you can say tell us that the title was
probably
title came first?
The bathtub piece. It's called Assisted Living. Maybe that one.
Assisted Living, yeah. That's
I
one
think
of
it's because I'm getting to that point in my life.
Fingers rubbing the shipples.
It was arranged differently before, but I changed it. I took it out.
You could maybe guess where the one of the fingers was. Yes. Thank you.